Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Can anybody use this faculty club? Like, come here for food, or is it?
Yeah. Well, you have to pay.
No.
And
I mean,
it is restricted,
like,
at various points. No, it's not just for the faculty.
You know.
You know, like the Senate executive dining room or some equivalent.
No. It's not. Well, I suppose there is probably an order of priority that, if you remember. You kind of can reserve things. There's a membership, and members pay, and, you know, and I suppose members get dibs when they want to rent or use rooms.
Okay, but just for, like, the lunchroom.
But for the lunchroom or everything else, yes.
I should just,
you can come in and pay. You should.
Well,
free Wi-Fi.
Actually,
free Wi-Fi.
Well, I live in San Francisco. So
okay.
But my husband's actually just finishing he's the journalist in residence at the Simons Institute.
Oh, okay.
So
yeah.
He's like a stone's throw for me.
Okay. Okay. Oh, excellent.
Mean and vicious.
Okay.
Hello.
Brad. Here we are.
Good to see you. I've wrestled with Brad before on stage.
Right.
Remember that in Berkeley Ideas Festival?
Yep. So you actually aren't going to this conference at all. You're just hanging out here this small sunlight-free room interviewing people for hour-long chunks, 16 hours a day.
Well, I did. I enjoyed it yesterday. I was a pure spectator yesterday.
Okay.
But yeah, not a day, unfortunately. But I honestly, it's a great way to spend my day.
So you're going to do
interview
eight?
Interview people like you.
So
and then you
can
put
the laser back on. That would be a good point.
You know what,
we're going to be knee to knee here, just given the room we got.
So let me see. If you put up 2 hours a week of these and do eight of these today, you get a month's worth of this part of your job done.
It's only 20 minutes.
We'd love for them, but in general.
So then how many are you doing?
Today, about eight.
Seven
or eight?
Seven. And what, you put up one a day or one a week?
Well, it's not clear how we'll float them out, but we'll have it. We actually, I don't know if you remember, I think we had yours up from the Berkeley Ideas Festival,
definitely.
If I recall, right?
Yeah.
We don't always, like, sometimes if I do other things on stage, like this year I did the Berkeley Ideas, we didn't video it.
No.
But in this case, this is spot on what we're really interested in the future work.
Mm-hmm.
I know, I think I've seen you retweeted my California is the Future reframe. So there's a kind of political things we were doing, but also future work around, which is kind of what we're really going on here. And then future sharing economy, we've done some stuff with different projects.
I'm just talking about
the
perfectionist. Can I make your
hair?
Sure. She's the producer, so.
She's
doing the same with me. So what we're going to do, given the time, okay, we're in good shape, actually. This is actually rolling. So you're just going to have a conversation with me.
Yeah.
They're going to double hit you there. They're going to establish shot with us and get me through this one. I will actually introduce it by looking this way.
Sure.
I guess he should be. So you got to, I've noticed you've been moving the camera this way. So
yeah.
So basically, I'm talking to you.
Yeah. But you get to break the fourth wall at the start.
Exactly.
You're looking
at
the
end of the end.
It's the wide cut.
Okay. Oh, I see. So this is just focused on me? So we're not doing wide. Okay.
I am out doing wide at the beginning. Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, great. That's probably a good idea. Okay, so are you chair of the political economy of industrial science?
Actually, no. No longer so. I've managed to throw that job off.
How would you want to be identified then?
I would want to be identified as professor of economics at UC Berkeley, as a research associate of the National Bureau of Economic Research, as a weblogger for the Washington Center for Equitable Growth, and as a newly installed chief economist at the Blum Center for Developing Economies.
We can definitely get all that in your bio.
Yeah.
But for on camera, what's that last one, too? Because that's interesting. I mean, I
was newly installed as the chief economist of the Blum Center for Developing Economies.
Which is here, right?
Yep.
Blum Center?
So, one at Berkeley professor and newly installed as chief economist at the Blum Center for Developing Economies.
That's interesting. I didn't know that.
Yeah, very
and your updated bio, I'm assuming on your website you have all those other
relationships.
I'll be in touch to get your photo.
Yeah, we'll get all that.
It was strangely enough anti-nepotism play.
What do you mean?
My second cousin is director of the Blum Center.
Okay.
And she said that word had come down from high from Richard Blum that there were more economists and less sociologists involved. So she said, who can I put the arm on?
Oh,
lo and behold.
Well, that's good. So what we're going to do here, given in a relatively tight frame, is there's a series of questions here that we're asking a variety of people here.
Okay.
Kind of bigger picture, generic things, but are kind of probing, giving you a lot of room to run. And so that's pretty much, as opposed to going into specifics on what you're doing necessarily.
Right.
But I will introduce you that way. Okay, we ready on the shots there? So bigger things, like, you know, how would you characterize kind of the historical moment we're in? What are the kind of big challenges that worry you most? Those kind of things like that'll allow you to just go in. With the whole idea here being, future work, future the platform economy, future of, automation. I mean, those are the driving things we're exploring here. You doing good?
And don't look at me.
That's all good.
Yeah.
And how someone, I've been missing all the politics, but how is the tax scam going through right now?
It looks like it has a 75% chance of making it through the Senate in the near term. And then it goes to a conference committee, or it doesn't. That is, or Paul Ryan simply decides to pass it through the House as is on the grounds that it's a turkey and he wants to get it off stage. In which then there's the next step would be the last ditch effort to convince the California Republican House delegation that they need to vote against this thing. Or else there'll be no net welfare.
But the 25%, I heard that
25% it's completely unclear.
It's unclear, okay.
I mean, they haven't written a bill. There is no bill at this moment.
Well, it's just interesting things there.
They have no idea what they've done, or how many loopholes are in there, or how big the loopholes are. Or indeed, what the incentives are.
We ready, by the way?
Yeah.
Okay, we might have to jump. I would love to hear that.
Yeah.
But I think we should
jump
back here to what we got to do because we do have someone coming after us, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But I'm with you on this. It's driving me freaking nuts.
Okay.
But we won't go there this
time.
You guys ready? 1 o'clock.
Okay.
Good. Good. All right, I'm gonna be looking over. So you want me looking in here? Over your shoulder?
Yeah. You start the timer. Okay.
Yeah, give me the timer. Good. Hello, I'm Pete Leiden. I'm the founder of Reinvent the Media Company, driving these conversations on the future of work. And today we've got Brad DeLong with us, who's an economics professor here at UC Berkeley. He's also the recently installed chief economist for the Blum Center for Developing Economy. It's good to have you here.
Great.
So we're here in a moment here with all the folks from the OECD and economists from the United States here, technologists. If you had to think about the kind of moment we're in right now, I mean, how would you characterize where we are in the kind of evolution of the global economy and where our technologies are? Is there anything special about this moment, anything critical about it, any ways you think about this juncture?
Well, let me give you a three-part answer to that.
Okay.
There's a 50-year horizon answer, a 15-year horizon answer, and then a 0 to 5-year horizon answer. And the 0 to 5-year horizon answer is that America has been deeply scarred by the financial crisis that started in 2007, the deep recession that happened, and the extraordinarily anemic recovery since, which still leaves us with something like 4 million people less in the labor force and looking for jobs than we ought to have right now, and we're not sure what all of them are doing. A good deal of them are living in their sisters' basements playing video games. But the economy and people's expectations of it have been shocked, and the economy and how well our society functions is still deeply scarred from that. And we're recovering only slowly, if at all, from that back to what we used to think was normal. So that's the 0 to 5-year situation. The 50-year situation is the collapse of a great many tasks that people used to do or are still doing to provide value in the economy. That an awful lot of paper shuffling tasks in the next 50 years are going to be taken over by software bots. And an awful lot of generally blue collar, traditionally male tasks are going to be taken over by robots one way or another. And some occupations will disappear, many occupations will be transformed, the income and wealth distribution will be upset either in a positive or a negative direction from this 50-year frame. And this 50-year process is what those of us upstairs at this conference are mostly worrying about. And then there's a 10 to 15-year frame, which is how much of this is going to happen in the next 15 years as opposed to the next 50. How fast is the 50-year process going to come upon us? And where exactly will be the first sectors and first places in which the coming of, call it the rise of the robots, both the replacement not just of blue-collar manufacturing workers, but also blue-collar construction and blue-collar transportation and distribution warehouse workers are going to be hit by the coming of technology, and also where a good deal of the of what used to be white collar work is going to start disappearing as expert systems and software bots take it over.
So pretty important juncture, it sounds like, if I'm your point of view.
Yeah.
In terms of, I mean, in your career, would you, I mean, just, is this about as momentous a time as you've seen, is that overhyping it?
The fact that we are recovering from the macroeconomic catastrophe that started in 2007 has definitely made it very fraught. The failure of our electoral college system to actually deliver us a competent president in 2016 has also produced a situation that is greatly fraught. The fact that our political system, basically our political system has been hacked partially by malevolent people, but mostly by time, circumstance, chaos, and disaster, has been hacked in three ways. The first way is the Electoral College failure that gave us a president who really is not up to the job in practically any dimension. Second, the fact that the small states hacked the Constitution in 1787. So we now have a world in which the minority in the Senate represents 175 million people, while the majority represents 145 million people. So we have a desperately minority government that understands it's a minority government and is kind of reacting oddly as a result. And third, the gerrymandering that took place after the 2010 census. That means the House of Representatives is also extraordinarily unrepresentative of the median American voter. These created a time of great political fraughtness as well. But you know, the economic fraughtness left over from 2007, the political fraughtness from the fact that we have clearly have a very badly broken political system, those accentuate, greatly deepen, and increase the dangers of managing what I call the 50-year transition. You know, and that 50-year transition has been going on, well, certainly since Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak began building personal computers in the garage. You know, and it's been going on at a more or less constant pace, and we see a little bit more about where it's heading, where it's making its head with each passing year. It really hasn't sped up much.
So there's three kind of areas we've been wrestling with here on kind of challenges.
Mm-hmm.
There's a kind of a portion of the, you mentioned one of them, the robot AI.
Yeah.
But there's this whole other idea of the economy moving towards more and more independent workers,
mm-hmm.
kind of nature of work changing that way. And then also this rise of the platform economy. And
mm-hmm.
I'm just curious, how do you think of those other two challenges? How important the developments are those, and how much do they concern you or actually encourage you as something that's a good thing?
Which do you want to talk about first, the platform economy or the...
Say the platform economy, the platform economy.
Yeah, and the platform economy has a number of different dimensions. You'd say what Hal Varian was talking about yesterday, about the kind of end of scale, that with Amazon Web Services and with Google, practically anyone with a good idea can launch their website at teeny scale for pennies. And thus providing through the web whatever service or commodity they want to provide. And then if demand is there, they can scale up costlessly. And as they scale up, all the way they can scale up, they can use world-class efficiency systems to support their business. So all of a sudden, you don't need a large initial lump of capital of any kind to start a business. You can just start it and look for demand and use the web and search in order to attract customers. And that this should be the cause of an enormous upward surge in entrepreneurship, enterprise, and a great flourishing of creativity.
Yeah.
Whether it's individuals with an extra 4 hours a week making extra money by driving for Lyft, or whether it's writers saying, I don't want to have to sell books at $20 and get only $1.50 in royalties, I want to establish my own Patreon and have my fans pay me directly, and they'll each pay a quarter as much, but as long as I can get a quarter of the reach, I'm still coming out ahead. Or any of a whole bunch of other things. The possibilities for positive human flourishing from the platform economy are immense, provided the platforms actually work. Right? That right now we find we're in a world in which Uber, in which riders are paying essentially 60% of Uber's costs, and Uber's investors are paying 40% of Uber's costs. And the question is, what happens when the investors begin wanting their money back rather than pouring it in? Do then we find that Uber has enough economies of scale and scope and enough of a brand and a first mover advantage that it's a profitable business? Do we find that the business gets taken over by somebody else? Most prominently Google, which decides to put a little taxi ride button on every Google Maps screen and say, we'll only charge you $1.50 as a handling fee, as opposed to Uber, which will charge you considerably more, which has to repay its investors. And we'll find that Uber has done a wonderful trail-breaking thing, but has suffered the fate of most pioneers. They wind up with arrows in their backs, face down. Or will it turn out that the platform economy is really not such a good thing because it moves bargaining power away from the real producers who are doing the work and also away from the customers and into the hands of that one large company in the middle that controls the information.
Mm-hmm.
And that's still up for grabs. You know, most people who fear that we are, as the extremely sharp Zeynep Cheki of Duke says, you know, building a utopia, building a dystopia one brick at a time in order to trigger people to click on ads, greatly fear that individual humans, given our cognitive disabilities, will be no match for an organization in the middle using deep learning and information to figure out how to trigger and control us. Others are much more optimistic, although not necessarily much more optimistic about platform pioneers like Uber. They're more optimistic about large companies that have entrenched dominant positions like Apple, Google, and Facebook. Although, if there is any
more optimistic of what?
Of how well they will do. Yeah.
They will do for everybody, or do for themselves.
They will do well and do good.
Do good. And where do you fall in that, actually?
I'm basically a techno-optimist. It's hard not to be a techno-optimist in California if you're an intellectual person who loves information.
Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm. So you think, even though there's these challenges, the platform economy, we could get beyond.
Yeah.
What about, as an economist, this other thread, though, about independent workers increasingly? There's a positive way to see that, and there's also challenges to that. I'm curious how you see that, that challenge.
Well, independent workers have, by their nature, very little bargaining power over what economists call rents embedded in the system. That there's always, you know, what you can demand charge on your own, which is if you walk, what would whoever's employing you or paying you or buying from you or whatever have to pay in order to get someone else to step up to it? And there's always, what power do you have? Because when you walk, you disrupt a general production value chain, and it's expensive, you know, to figure out how to replace you, even if there's someone else who certainly could do the job just as well. And a lot of successful middle-class society has been based on relatively low-level workers being able to share big time in these economic rents. Governor Granholm of Michigan yesterday told a heartbreaking story about a town in central Michigan, 8,000 people, of whom 3,000 work in the refrigerator plant. Those 3,000 workers make a very good living for Michigan at the start of the 2000s, $35 an hour, I think, in wages and benefits. But the refrigerator plant goes to Ciudad Juarez, and they're left being lucky to make $12 or $15 an hour, because their skills, their machines, their lifetime of experience bashing metal and forming operating things that form refrigerator coils. There's really not much demand for that, and they truly can't transfer their skills to anything else of great value, because the principal source of their income was sharing in the rents created by refrigeration companies' dominant market positions and embedded technology. And that's a danger that's going to happen to a lot of people who become independent workers. On the other hand, it's not bound to be destructive as long as we have a middle-class society. That is, there's immense amounts of work to be done for each other. But if you want to think about it, think of it as being that the typical job in the economy goes from being a manufacturing worker to being a barista at a coffee shop or being a teacher at a yoga studio. And as long as you have a middle class society in which the middle class is wealthy, there'll be a lot of people who'll be willing to pay a lot for yoga lessons or be willing to pay an extra $1.50 for a particular espresso beverage brewed exactly the way they like it. With a smile, a handshake, and a 3-minute conversation about how they're doing while the thing brews from the barista behind it. If we have a plutocracy in which the only people who have a lot of money are the rich, well then the potential customers for the yoga studio won't be able to pay very much, will they? and your fancy espresso drink won't command very much. That instead, the only people who make middle-class lives will be those who control resources that are useful for making things for which rich people have a Jones. And there'll be relatively few of those as well. So most of it is the shape of what the income distribution will be, which is ultimately a political choice about the distribution of wealth. Because an unequal distribution of wealth will drive an unequal distribution of income that will reproduce itself, while an equal distribution of wealth will drive a more equal distribution of income, which will also reproduce itself.
Oops, oh, we just pulled the light off. Sorry. Sorry, I had to give her off. Okay, ready? So you've kind of given, as is probably right, you know, it could go this way, could go that way. Could be positive, could be negative. And I get that, and that's a good choices there.
This is why the economists want Duck to have two hands, but also a prehensile tail.
But in that respect, what do you see as the most promising ways forward to kind of deal with this juncture we're in, kind of tip the balance towards this more, what you're kind of seeing there? And again, there's a laundry list of this, so we're just think about, you know, your own, what to you are the most important, let's say, things that you'd like to see happen soon here that would actually kind of evolve this economy in a direction that is healthy?
Am I allowed to say a 4% inflation target in the Federal Reserve? Yeah, that a Federal Reserve that is less focused on keeping inflation very low and more focused on keeping employment high and on making sure that there's enough inflation in the system that the Federal Reserve can maintain interest rates at a level at which it will, you know, have the power to stabilize the economy. Because businesses are not going to want to train their workers unless workers are scarce. And workers tend to be scarce only in what we call a high-pressure economy. So that the first and most important thing would be to change the calculation of businesses that might be willing to invest in training workers so that they feel that workers are valuable commodities under their control that they need to boost the value of, rather than has been totally the case since 2008, and largely the case since 2001, that, you know, there are plenty of workers out there who could do any of these jobs, and we really don't care about them because the bottlenecks keeping us from being more profitable are elsewhere. You know, making labor a serious bottleneck, again, for business in order to focus business on helping workers become more productive and more useful is, I think, the first thing we could do. The second thing would be to repeat what Silicon Valley did in the 1980s and 1990s. That is, you're old enough to remember the coming of the Macintosh computer in 1984. And, you know, how Apple bought Super Bowl time for a dystopian 1984 Cooper TV commercial about how important the machine would be, and about how they really believed that the personal computer was an engine of freedom. That is, that it allowed you to control and access your own information, rather than having to rely on some human resource department or some IT department backed by some large mainframe that had lots of data that you weren't allowed to access and that controlled your life in various ways. Because you were merely a serf who didn't understand the situation, while the valuable parts of how the thing worked, the information, was kept under lock and key in the hands of, you know, that the kind of world in which people would take their draft cards and burn them, in which your information would come on 5 IBM cards, you know, which would all say do not fold, spindle, or mutilate on them, and which you would always have to feed into the machine face down and 9-edge first, and in which those cards produced decisions over which you felt like you had no control. That making information technology tools to augment people's abilities to figure out and maneuver in the world that they were in rather than information technology being a tool that, say, led corporate management to say, you are 15% less productive at processing claims or at successfully turning sales cues, sales clues into actual sales than other people. We don't need you around. The whole idea of information technology and as a way of augmenting human intelligence and productivity, rather than information technology as a way that we can substitute capital for labor and get these annoying workers out of the factory and still produce as much. That was a key and a revolutionary social goal of Silicon Valley as it existed in the 1980s and 1990s, from the coming of the personal computer to the flourishing of the internet. And in some sense, Silicon Valley has to figure out how to do this again. And organizations like, say, Berkeley's engineering school kind of have to help them. Because large companies, certainly, they tend to be much more interested in figuring out how to use information technology to shed annoying and expensive workers, rather than how to give those annoying and expensive workers more control over their lives.
Well, that's fascinating. So the big challenge to the tech world, as well as the challenge to policymakers, I wish we had more time to kind of go deeper into many, many possible solutions there, but just to wind up here, big challenges, possible big solution shifts. How confident are you that we're going to manage this transition here, whether it's the 5-year, 15-year transition? How confident are you we're going to do it, or how worried are you?
I would say I'm not confident at all. I'd say that our income distribution now, wealth distribution, appears to have managed to tilt itself in a bad way. And certainly in an economy, if you want the economy to pay attention to you, you'd better have money. And the money is too concentrated now. And if you want the polity to pay attention to you, you better have a movement. And yet somehow it seems that the age of the internet and of the decline of manufacturing is one in which it is much harder rather than easier to create durable social movements. And it's much easier to create the appearance of a social movement via, robotic software bots controlled by some server in Yugoslavia, right? That what was the cartoon? 1980, my light bulb produces 10 times as much heat as light. My incandescent light bulb produces 10 times as much heat as light. 2017, my LED light bulb has been taken over and is now running a botnet of 50,000 Twitter followers from controlled by a server in Yugoslavia, or in the former Yugoslavia. That seems to be the world we're moving into, and it's not a terribly reassuring one.
Well, that's a good place to end. At least a sobering thought, and thanks so much for joining us.
You're very welcome. It's a great pleasure. Bring you back again.
I will. Boom, thanks. I wish we did have more time. Love the phone here.
Yeah, so we might have, watch it, you got this dropping.
Where's your office?
In the Mission.
Oh,
so we
okay.
could do a deeper dive over there.
You can come down to the Mission, and then I could persuade my daughter to meet me at Mission Chinese for dinner.
Do you like that?
I do like Mission Chinese, right?
What? Oh, wait, hey, Caitlin, can you help him get out of here? He's,
yes.
We gotta always, let her solve that.
Okay.
I think it's a bit of a mess.
Being able to untangle a microphone code should be within the power of every East African slave.
But not a robot. How long will it take the robots to be able to do that?
Actually, not that much longer, Stuart Feldman was saying.
What did you make of Stuart?
I don't think Stuart is a crazy person. But he's incredibly smart. And he thinks he's a very smart person and thinks very differently than I do.
Agreed. No, I think we're going to try to actually talk to him as well. But thank you so much for that. We'll send out the links, the material, and we'll see you again.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great.
You're welcome. You got your phone back?
I did.
Okay.
Sure.
We'll see you next time.
Sure. Thank you.